Okay, we'll go ahead and get started. Everyone's ready? Welcome to the March meeting. Cabarrus County Big Beavers, it seems like time is going really fast all of a sudden. So I know next time we come back up, we'll be in a big hunting club, so. Bees are getting ready. If we can get the weather to get them ready, so. Just a reminder, 50-50 tickets over Mike Wallace and door prize tickets as well, if you haven't got your names in the hat. You can do that before we draw. Tonight, we have Greg Ferris, the North Carolina Bee Inspector in our area. He's going to talk about swarms tonight, so we're going to let him get started. So Greg, come on and share with us, and we appreciate you being here.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks for having me tonight. Appreciate it. And great meal. You guys get the best food, don't you?
Yes.
I've been asked tonight to talk about swarm. And in particular, I'm going to talk about swarm prevention and swarm control. Both of those. Let me see if we can get this thing to cooperate. Is that focused? You guys have a hard time. Okay, so tonight I'm going to talk about why bees swarm. What happens, what are the steps that they kind of go through? Preventing swarms, stopping swarm preparations, and then what doesn't work. And if y'all have any comments, any questions, just call them out. It's a good sized group of people, and we can, I think, discuss things with each other pretty easily. So let's talk about why it is that they swarm. And of course, it's a natural method of colony reproduction. That's what swarming is. It's a response to the amount of brood in bees versus the amount of space in the hive. In other words, overcrowding. And the amount of the distribution of queen substance. So when you've got a colony that's all overcrowded, as you know, the queen substance that's put out by the queen, it's passed around by the workers pretty much by physical contact. So when you have a really crowded hive, individual bees can't move through the hive as freely as they did before. So the queen substance doesn't get distributed evenly like it normally would. It's not crowded. Does that make sense? And there's also the hive conditions or the hive environment. In other words, things like temperature and such, how much room we actually have. Causes of swarming aren't completely known, you know what I mean? However, they do know that associated with swarming is that strong, healthy colonies swarm, not sick ones. Okay? Typically, sick colonies don't swarm. And it's strongly influenced by, say, that the not having enough queen substance. So, and that can be the result of poor production, as in the queen's age, her genetics, or her rearing conditions, how she was reared, or poor distribution, overcrowding, congestion, like I just mentioned. And that poor queen substance distribution leads to queen cup construction by the workers. So if you wonder, why is it that my bees are, why is it they built the queen cups here and there? Does that mean that they're getting ready to swarm? Not necessarily. As you may know, there are certain lines of bees that like to build queen cups, even queen cells sometimes, and then they tear them down. For instance, the Russian line will do that. So once they have built, the workers have built queen cups here and there around, then the queen will lay fertilized eggs in those queen cups. So she lays eggs in those cups over several days. When it's swarm season, she usually chooses cups that are on the lower margin, as in along the bottom of the frames like that, but not always. Okay. Sometimes she'll return to those cells and tear them down. And the workers do not force the queen to lay into those cups. Or they don't prevent her from destroying any queen cells, if she chooses to. Once there are eggs in the cups, then it's no longer a queen cup, now it's a queen cell, right? Just by definition, right? So at that point then, thereafter, getting the queen mother to lose a bunch of weight so that she'll be able to leave with the swarm. So about 1/3 of her weight is what she needs to lose, and the workers will treat the queen real roughly. They'll kind of rough her up. They'll run her around the hive to try and get her to, you know, thin down some. Okay. She'll greatly reduce her egg-laying rate. Okay. And then as swarm day approaches, there'll be scout bees who go out and look for a new place for the swarm to move into. So these are all the steps that the bees are going through heading towards swarming, just as a reminder. At swarm time, a few bees will run through the hive doing a whirring, like zigzag kind of dance, which is the signal then for the bees to leave. They're going to leave with the swarm. So they'll rush out the entrance, fly in a circular pattern, and then they'll settle on something, a tree or a fence post or, you know, whatever. And their average height of settling is 10 feet off the ground. I'm not sure where that number comes from, as in what research did. I don't know you all, I've hive swarms that were in a bush where you just push the hive underneath, you know what I mean? The bees practically fall right into it. But then you've all seen ones too that are 30 feet up in some tree, right? Which if I was, you know, 22 years old, I might be, oh, I'll get up there. I want to think I've gotten wiser, you know what I mean? And swarms typically leave like in the center of the day, 10 to 2 p.m., and they take about 10 or 15 minutes to come out of the hive. Which bees join the swarm is somewhat random, okay? The majority of them are between those ages, 4 and 23 days old, and they have a high proportion of wax workers, a high proportion of workers whose wax glands are active. And that makes perfect sense, because when they hit their new home, and the first thing they got to do is have some place where the queen can start laying. They have to have some place where they can bring in nectar and pollen and store it. They have to have beeswax comb, right? So having a lot of wax workers along with them makes sense. They can start building comb immediately. Drones will go along with the swarm, and small hive beetles and varroa mites will go along with them. Okay, now varroa, you know, rides on the bees, you know, at the frantic stage of the bees. Small hive beetles, they fly along with the swarm. They'll go wherever they want to go. When the bees cluster, like they are here, or like that, when they find a place to settle, they might stay there for a few hours, they might stay there for days. Has anybody hive swarm that has been there for days? They're usually not happy bees. They're a little testy if they've been there for some time. On the other hand, one that has just, a swarm that has been there just for a short period of time, very easy to work with, very gentle. I encourage you that if you get an opportunity to hive a swarm and you haven't done that before, certainly give it a try. Definitely give it a try. If you've hived some swarms in the past, if you get a call and somebody says, oh, there's a swarm of bees in my backyard, will you come get it? And it's like in a development where there'll be lots of people around to watch it, definitely go and do it. Because you look magical, you know what I mean, as you get these bees together in the boxes. But really, of course, the reason the swarms are so gentle is because they don't have a home to defend. Typically, bees will only sting you for two reasons. One is if you press on them, they have a reflex that their stinger will extend. And the other reason is in defense of our home. So when they're out as a swarm, hanging like this, waiting for the scout bees to come up with the new place, they are super gentle, very gentle. Those people in the development don't know. Okay, when all these scout bees that are out looking for, you know, a place to move into, when they all agree on the site, they will do a whirring dance again on the face of the swarm. Very interesting how it is that the scouts communicate with each other about sites that they have found, new places. It's kind of a competition between the various scouts as to who has found the best place. And when they arrive at the decision who found the best place, then the dance and off they go. As soon as they get there, wax construction begins right away. The queen regains her weight very quickly, and she begins egg laying. In the wild, swarms survive. Their survival of swarms in the wild is less than 25%. Whereas beekeepers, of course, we can hive swarms and keep them indefinitely for as long as they live. That 25% swarm survival in the wild, that's awfully low, that is. And that just points out the difference in conditions between a hollow tree and the hive that you give bees. You give them a fantastic place for bees to live. It's got foundation, it's watertight, the rain doesn't get in, the wind doesn't blow through it, all those things that you can end up with in a hollow tree that the bees would have to try and seal all up. You give them something that's already done. Thus, you can get bees to live for a long period of time, even though the survival rate in the wild is so poor. In the wild, swarming takes place just before the main nectar flow. Does not take place during the main nectar flow. And again, this makes perfect sense, that if you're going to do colony reproduction, that you throw that swarm out there, that new colony out there, let them get set up some, and then main nectar flow, lots and lots of food. And the thing that keeps the wax glands, you know, active, of course, is incoming nectar. So just before the main nectar flow is when it is that they typically swarm. And that goes for your bees too. Certainly are some exceptions, depends on how it is you've been doing late winter and early spring management, as to whether you've gotten them to kind of build up already. How many people have their bait hives up already if they do bait hives? Okay, so these are bait hives that are put up to catch swarms. Maybe your own swarms, maybe somebody else's swarms. If you haven't put yours up yet and you plan on doing it this year, I suggest you do it immediately. Yeah. I believe that with the way our bees have been building up so far, with the few colonies that I've seen so far, and then my own also, that as soon as the weather turns, gets warm again, we're going to start seeing a lot of swarms. I looked at somebody's bees down south of Charlotte last week, and he said he had already caught two swarms this year. So it's very close. And I think next week, Thursday, Friday, things are supposed to get in the 60s. So if you can beat the warm weather and get your bait hives up, then you may catch somebody else's swarms or some of your own. So five steps to take so that bees don't start swarm cells, okay? Plenty of room for egg laying in the brood nest, enough room for nectar storage and processing. Remember that if you looked at all the space that the nectar takes, and then when the bees dry all the water out of that, the amount of space that the honey takes up as a result, they need much more processing space than the final amount of storage space. Does that make sense? So if you're going to give them space to put their store their honey, you want to give them more than you think they need. You want to make sure that they have enough space to bring in plenty of nectar, to process it, dry the water out, and in order to make it into honey. That helps with the crowding. Lots of space. place your hives in full sun, you get better varroa and small hive beetle control if your hives are in the full sun all day long. And then, of course, having the sun come up and be right on your hives encourages the foragers to start working earlier than they normally do. And that's good. When there's a big a nectar flow on there, you want your foragers out for as long as possible each day. Provide enough ventilation. This is something that I see off and on where, I don't know where the beekeepers have gotten the idea, but they keep their entrance reducers all year down to a little tiny space, about 2 or 3 bees wide. And they think that that's what we're supposed to do with beekeeping. And I disagree with it. If you want to make a bunch of honey, you've got to leave them enough space to dry that water out, to get that humid air out of the hive. And if all you've left is a little space, they don't have the ventilation that they need to be able to do that. Many beekeepers in the past, that as a colony grows in the springtime, they'll start out with that little space for the winter time, and then every few days they'll make it bigger and bigger until they have a wide open entrance. It just needs, it only has to do with whether or not they can guard the space. So it ought to be a large enough colony that they can guard a wide open entrance. So ventilation is going to be important, particularly when it comes to drying the nectar, the honey. And most importantly, you ought to have young queens that head all the colonies. My favorite guy, Dr. Karen, because I had his courses in school years back. I went to the University of Delaware, and he was a professor there at the time. He's saying that you are going to make the most honey, and you're going to minimize your swarming if you have first-year queens. And that is research after research after research shows that. So let's talk about things that you can do aside from those reasons, things that you can do to prevent swarming. Okay? So this is before you see any queen cells. Okay? So you've gone in your hive, you're looking at, you're looking through frame by frame, you don't see any queen cells at all. Might be some queen cups here and there, but when you turn the frame and look inside the queen cups, there's never an egg in one of those. As soon as you see an egg in a queen cup, it's a queen cell, you know that swarming is underway. So before that, before there are any eggs in any queen cups, equalizing colonies used to be a common thing among beekeepers. In fact, it was considered good beekeeping to do this. In the last 10, I don't know, 15 years, it seems to have kind of gotten lost. I rarely hear anybody talking about equalizing their colonies. And what it involves is, if you have, let's say, 4 colonies, and 2 of them are great big, coming out of the winter, they're doing just fine, and the other 2 are not, they're coming along slow, etc. That one way to help reduce the swarming on those 2 large colonies is by giving the queen more laying space. And you can benefit those big colonies and the little ones by pulling out frames of capped brood with the adhering bees. You want the same bees on there, because you got to have enough bees on the frame to cover the developing brood to keep it warm, right? So then you turn and you put that into the weak colonies. This time of year, springtime, it's hard to get bees to fight with each other. They're generally so busy in and out, pollen, nectar, trying to get themselves started building up during the springtime, that when you add another frame of brood to the weaker colonies, 1 frame, 2 frames even, they hardly even notice. What that does for the smaller colonies, of course, is there'll be this sudden increase in worker population when all those bees emerge. What limits the growth of colonies during this time of year is the number of bees there are to cover developing brood. They can only raise as much as they can cover, right? Makes sense. So with each rotation with each a set of workers, each set of 21 days. You get this big jump in the number of workers, and so the brood nest can't expand that much. By equalizing colonies, by pulling frames of capped brood out of big colonies and giving it to small ones, you've all of a sudden made it so these small colonies can cover much more brood than they could before. So now the queens in those smaller colonies can start laying up to their potential. Makes sense? So equalizing colonies is great. Now what does it do for the big colonies? The big colonies, when you take those capped brood frames out to give to the small ones, you take an empty drawn comb, it can even be foundation, out of the small colonies and put them into the large ones. So you've now just opened up a whole bunch of space. You've opened up space for the queen to lay in, if it's drawn comb, or you've opened up space for the wax workers to work on building comb if it's foundation. Equalizing colonies, good practice. One that's been kind of lost, try it with your own bees. I think you'll be amazed at what that does for the weaker colonies in particular. Reversing boxes. So here it is, you're coming out of the winter. So you have the cluster of bees that is up high in that top box because they've been working their way up, eating honey all winter long as it goes, right? So you take that top box and you put it on the bottom board, and you take what was the bottom box and put it on top. Because the bottom box is full of empty frames, right? So then that puts them in the proper arrangement for, according to honeybee biology, and that is brood below and food above. It so happens this time of year, there isn't any food above, but that's an added motivator for them to get to work on bringing in nectar to process. If the brood nest straddles the two boxes, don't reverse it. If you do, then you end up with part of the brood nest up here and part of the brood nest down there, and of course, bees will always cover their brood. So you end up splitting the cluster in half. Okay? If it's a fairly small cluster, that could be really detrimental to those bees. They may not be able to cover all the brood, and so you have a lot of chilled brood. In other words, you could really put a stop to the colony's growth by reversing when you split the brood nest. Anybody here keep bees on mediums? Anybody does? Yeah. I do too. You winter in three? In three? Yeah, me too. That becomes an extra challenge for you, right, when it comes to how do you reverse three boxes? So then you have to apply the principle, of course, you know that. But what you're doing is you're trying to put empty space up above where the brood nest is, so that they're encouraged to start working with lots of nectar processing. If you find that you have a brood nest that's between a couple of mediums, then all you can do is kind of treat that as a unit. Right? It gets moved as well. Sounds like I'm telling you guys stuff here already. I've experienced with it. And there's checkerboarding. Don't do this when the nights are still down below 50. Okay? And the reason being is because you're taking frames from the outside here and putting them in between the crowded brood nest. You're expanding the brood nest out. Okay? And you want to make sure that there's enough bees to be able to cover the expanded brood nest. Does that make sense? So if the temperatures are above 60, then they can handle that. They don't have to keep that much space warm. If there are queen cells, okay, then we start looking at swarm control. So as soon as you see a cup with an egg in it, it's now a queen cell. As soon as you see a queen cell of any stage of development, you know that the rest of the colony is preparing to swarm. So the question becomes, is the queen there? And if you see queen cells like this, with little hatch door or one like this that's been cleaned, then you know that that queen has already emerged. She's already out. So we say, so what? So the colony already swarmed. Well, then you're doing swarm control doesn't make any sense because it's already out. The only danger that really happens at that point is how many new queens did they raise? Yeah. So if you have your first queen mother, she leaves and she leaves with half the workers. Off they go to set up a new home. And the bees that are left behind, they now have various virgin queens that are, in, that are emerging from these cells. So the first virgin queen could very well leave with half the workers that are left. The third one could be a tertiary, a third swarm that goes out. So the number of these queen cells that were along the bottom margin of the frame, the number of those ones in there could serve as the queen mother to each successive swarm. Yeah. So if you had a big colony that you were planning on making lots of honey for you, now half of the workers have left, and then half again, and then half again. You're left with this small group of bees. It's not going to make much of it, right? So you want to keep those colonies together. Right? You want to keep them from swarming if you can. Why not just make it split and divide the colony? For that very, I mean, making splits is generally considered good beekeeping. It's great for increasing the number of colonies if that's what you want. It's good for making insurance nukes. Yeah. There are lots of people who will make an extra nuke or two on the side during the springtime and then just hold those nukes in their apiary in case they lose a queen or something happens to one of their regular sized colonies, or they have a ready small colony to use to help any colony that's not doing well. And some people do it for they gain some varroa control by making splits, as in you get a break in the brood cycle. You get a period of time when all the mites are out on the backs of the bees, and that's when they're more vulnerable. However, dividing your large colonies severely reduces your honey production. Research shows that one large colony will produce much more honey than two half colonies added together. You might say, well, why is that? If you look at what the bees are doing, what their jobs are, in a large colony, you have a really big foraging force. In the two small colonies, a lot of the worker bees, they're tied up with doing domestic things. Everything from being a nurse bee to house cleaning to taking nectar and pollen from incoming foragers, that in that total population of bees, a much larger proportion is being used in order to support the colony. In a large colony, that same number to support the colony, but you have many more bees that are free to do foraging, right? So keeping the colony together when you see swarm signs, yeah, is a good thing, in particular if you want to make honey, right? Or if you want to expand the number of colonies you have, of course. The more bees you have, the more you have to work with. So once you see swarms and cells down, how do you keep it from swarming? All the successful methods of swarm control involve separating the queen and the brood. All of the ones that are successful separate the queen and the brood. I'll say it a third time, but it looks like many are asleep already, so there are lots of easy variations for doing that, for separating the queen and the brood, and it goes way back in time. You can go back into the 1800s easily and find descriptions of how to do swarm control. And the successful ones are the ones that separate the queen and the brood. So if the queen mother's still there, you can control swarming. Stop the swarming process, you gotta eliminate all the queen cells, both capped and uncapped ones, and then manipulate the colony so that it doesn't start queen rearing again. always involve separating the queen and the groom. Is that four times? I always show this method just because this method shows up in all kinds of like master beekeeping testing and all that kind of stuff. And it's a well-known, you know, method for doing swarm control. There are lots of variations on the Devrient method. And there are other methods also that are not methods, okay, but still involve separating those two. Okay. So this is was first described, this Demaray method, by George Demaray in the American Bee Journal in 1884. American Bee Journal has been around for a long time. So is the bee culture. Anybody know what bee culture used to be called?
Gleanings.
Gleanings, yes. Gleanings and bee culture. And when Kim shows up and asks him, what happened to gleanings and bee culture? He's really sick of hearing that question. So this method that he has, it separates the queen and the brood, but it keeps the rest of the colony together. Yeah. Yes, okay. Just make sure you're right. Okay. I'm going to show you this. Okay, Demaray, late 1800s. This gets built from the bottom up. So imagine on your hive stand, you have the big colony, then you looked inside and you found queen cells in there. Okay, so you know they're getting ready to swarm. However, you also saw the queen running around. Might be a marked queen that you have. So you know the queen mother's in there too. Okay. So what you do is, right next door to that big colony, you know, that you have, put down a bottom wort, okay, and then put down a deep. And then in that deep, put empty comb or foundation, doesn't matter, you know, either one of those is fine. And then the two frames that are in the center, take the queen mother and put her down here, along with another frame of like a mixed brood. In particular, open brood is great because you know you have lots of nurse bees with that. When you move those two frames down there from the big colony, take it with the adhering bees. Okay, put it down. So now you have the queen down here, all kinds of empty space on each side. Put the queen excluder on. Now put two boxes on top that have empty comb or foundation. Either one of those fine. Okay. What you're after is making space between the top of the colony and where the queen is down here. Okay. Am I making sense so far? Okay. Then in that colony, now you've got all kinds of bees, et cetera, left over that you haven't done anything with. Put them all on top. Okay. So everything that's left of that large colony that you had, put it all on the very top. Those bees up there are all far enough away from the queen that they'll believe they don't have a queen, and they'll start raising their own queen. What you need to do when you're in the process of moving these frames, you know, from the big one into this construction that you're doing right here, is on every frame look for queen cells, okay, and destroy them. Say, well, you know, how far do I have to go with destroying them? All you got to do is take your hive tool and dent it. If you do any damage at all to the queen cell, the workers will tear it down. Okay. So, go through, take care of all the different queen cells that are up on top, okay, so that they don't have any way, so that there's no queens that could, you know, leave with a swarm. Okay. You also need to go back in within 7 to 9 days and see if they've started to raise queens from any young larvae that are in these frames that are up here. And there's sure to be some. So you go through each one of those frames and look for emergency queen cells that they've started, and you destroy those. So now what you have is the whole population of bees all the way up on top, that have no way to raise a new queen. Okay? But the queen is down here being maintained. Verse B is 7. Okay, so you've kept the colony together by separating the queen from the brood.
How many boxes between the queen and the...
Two. Just these two. And then once you have accomplished that, put your supers on top. Just stack your super loop.
Does it matter if it's shallows or leaps or stoop?
Nope. Just enough to make enough space. And it doesn't take all that much that the queen substance is not keeping the colony together, so to speak, up on top. In other words, the workers up on top get the message out, we don't have a queen, we need a raise.
Will they come back down into the...
Yes, so they'll continue to go in and out the entrance down here, right? You can put a top entrance in up there if you like. And in fact, once the nectar flow starts in earnest, putting top entrance is a good idea. It makes it so the foragers can go in and out up there where the nectar is being stored up in the supers, rather than going to the bottom and then having to go all the way up. Once the main flow is over, you can take the queen excluder out and just combine them all back together. Demarray method. Is this the only method for swarm control? Absolutely not. There's a zillion other methods for doing effective swarm control that don't involve this kind of thing.
How long does it take them to find each other?
What do you mean?
Like, is there a certain amount of hours, days before the bees take the bees from the top and the ones on the bottom? But those two, when do you
And it'll be almost immediately. Because these ones up here are free to explore down this way. And the queen excluder, of course, the workers can just go through all the way down. There is a problem with drones, having drones up here. And that is, drones can't get through the queen excluder. And in fact, they'll, as smart as drones are, they end up jamming themselves into the queen excluder and dying there, trying to get through. So you taking off the lid on top, or providing an upper entrance, we'll let the drones, let them be picked up.
Hey, Greg, is that a better method than just taking the queen of two frames of brood, putting it in a union, and cutting it out?
It depends on the equipment you have. If you have new boxes, and you essentially, what you do then is you make a swarm.
Okay.
Right. You take the queen mothers and bees. Well. Right. And then the bees are left behind. If you decide to do that, again, let's take the queen mother out, put her in the box, and set her aside, somewhere. Then make sure that all the queen cells that are in the colony that's left behind are all destroyed, every single one. If you miss one, the colony is destroyed. My clicker's not working anymore. Just put new batteries in. But that's okay. There's also the Snellgrove board and a variety of other contraptions. This thing has these little doors that you open and close on the top and on the bottom. So it has a screen in the middle so the bees can't reach each other from top or the bottom. And then you control which doors are open and which ones are closed. In other words, where the bees can go in and out. And then you end up manipulating that. This is an interesting way to do it. It's common in Europe. If this tweaks your curiosity, certainly look into it. It involves this one open and this one open, and then in 3 days you do this, and you open those and these, and you close these, and then you do this one over here and that one. It's these steps that you go through in order to manipulate where the bees can go in and out of. And you can control swarming now.
Snellgrove. Okay, what doesn't work?
Flipping the queen's wings. When you order a queen, you can have the queen breeder mark the queen for you, as they put a dot on her thorax. And you can also pay a little to have her wings clipped. Actually, just one wing. And what happens is when a colony goes to swarm and all the workers are running out to take the queen on with them, and she goes running out with them and goes down the rise. And you, as a beekeeper, hopefully you'll come along and notice this little mass of bees down the grass. And when you see that, of course, always suspect that there's a queen in the middle. And if you start picking through, you know, you'll generally find her. But unfortunately, if they come out like that at 10 o'clock in the morning and you're off at work, you may never realize that that's what happened. I have seen I talked to a beekeeper who said that he caught a swarm, and when he saw the queen, she was a queen with a clipped wing. So she managed to go at the swarm somehow. I don't know how, but that's weird. Okay, so clipping the wings is not going to make sure that the colony doesn't swarm. Just stand here next to the computer. Okay, how about putting a piece of queen excluder across the entrance? So that makes it so the queen can't get out. It also makes it so that the drones can't get out. Yeah? In no time at all, they will plug up the whole, all the spaces in the queen excluder, with drones kind of get out. And then they'll get stuck there, they'll die there, and eventually have enough that closes off the entrance. And a lot of times, particularly if it's a large colony, they'll overheat. Okay? Overheat and die. So this isn't good. Plus, you know, remember that the workers are thinning down the queen so that she can fly with the rest. She may walk right through the queen's. So this doesn't work either. But the queen is their own thing. Doesn't keep them from swimming. And as I already mentioned, you can rely on finding and destroying every single queen cell that's in there. The challenge is where they are. Now, normally you can just take a box and like put it up on end and look at the bottoms of all the frames, right? Because swarm season, that's where the swarm cells are, okay? And you can see those there, and then you can just run your hive tool, you know, down those and destroy all those. They will build queen cells on whatever they think the bottom is. That might be partway up on a cell. I mean, partway up on a frame. Right? For instance, here's one here. There's the top bar of the frame. So here's one here that they've tucked in right on the edge there. Or sometimes they in communication holes, the places where they have chewed through, let's say wax foundation, if it's a wax comb you're working with, and sometimes they'll build queen cells that hang down in there. All they're doing is putting them on the lower margin, but the lower margin of them happens to be up on the frame. So if the only thing that you're destroying is queen cells that are on the very bottom, you're going to miss some that are filling up. You need to go through every single frame, looking all over the frame for queen cells. There's also, and I have certainly done this myself, and I've talked to plenty of other people that have done this, and that is they stand up like that, they seal these queen cells on the bottom, and so they just nuke them all with their hive tool. Yeah? And then they start running across queen cells or that already have the little trap door open. In other words, some of those have emerged. That means the queen mother's already gone. So there I was, I went down and destroyed all the queen cells. Now hopefully there's a virgin queen running around in there that, you know, from that little one who's going to be the queen. Okay. If I didn't see any of those little trapdoor ones and I went and I destroyed all the queen cells, okay, without realizing that the queen mother had already left, then what I have then is a colony that can't raise a new queen. Because the queen stopped laying away a while ago. And they need a larva that's like 1, 2, maybe 3 days old in order to raise a queen. So if they don't have that, they're out of luck. And I just totally ruined their luck by destroying all the queen cells that they had created. So just go along and destroying all the queen cells that you see, think twice before you do that. Make sure that this colony has a queen and a queen that's going to stay before you destroy all the new queens that those bees have created. Makes sense? I've done that plenty of times. Thank you. So, related to swarming, amount of bees, brood, available space, distribution of the queen substance in the hive environment. It occurs before the main nectar flow. Swarm prevention, you gotta provide lots of room for egg laying and for nectar processing and enough ventilation for them to move the warm air out and to regulate temperature, you know, in there. Okay. If you put them in full sun, then it encourages the foragers to start working early and it gives you better mite and small hive beetle control and use first year queens for the best, you know, honey production. And use checkerboarding and reversing to expand the brood nest. Don't use them when there are still cold day and night temperatures because you can, by spreading the brood nest out, you can make it so they there aren't enough bees to cover all the brood, the whole nest. When you find that swarm preparation is underway, use a method that separates the queen and the brood. Those are just a couple of examples of that. Making splits has its place, but it's not always the best solution. Okay? If you want to make a lot of honey, or if you want to expand the number of colonies that you have, you need either one of those, you need a lot of workers. A lot of workers. The more workers, the better. The more workers you have, the more honey they're going to make. The more workers you have, the more splits you can make. Lots of things that don't work. And please don't rely on bee soups as your source of how to do beekeeping. Because what that is that's a bunch of beekeepers like me just telling you, this is what I tried. And I think that this is what I tried on my two colonies in my backyard. And my colonies didn't die from mites this year, so, you know. Pouring Texas bee in there 3 times a year works great for controlling mites. That's the kind of conclusions that you get from a lot of people who don't create experimental conditions where they're sure about the conclusions that they draw. A lot of them don't even think of that. A lot of them are, I have one or two colonies and I do something to them and the result that I get, I think, is caused by what it is that I did to them, when the result that the bees have may be caused by something else completely different. What I'm thinking of mainly is things like essential oils. I've seen plenty of beekeepers say that I'm only going to use essential oils to control varroa mites in my colonies, and so they do. They mix up a concoction of spearmint and peppermint and wintergreen and various ones, whatever recipe they ran across in BeeSource, where somebody says, I use this recipe and it works great for my control. So they say, ooh, okay, I got something that is organic and can use that. And so they mix that up and they put that on their bees, and their bees die really well. How many people lost bees this year? You are certainly not alone. Losses in North Carolina this year were horrendous. I know a person in the mountains that had 100 colonies that lost 70.
Tell my wife that. She thinks I'm just a big dummy.
Be happy to talk to her. Be happy to talk to her. A lot of people lost a lot of bees. The speculation the inspectors had back in January was we're looking at 50-60% losses in North Carolina. And that's just a feeling, you know, a ballpark.
No. Was there a common cause?
Mm-hmm.
Was there a common cause that they sort of?
A lot of it was the what we've seen in the past, and that is a little fist-sized cluster that is dead. And that if you brush the dead bees aside, underneath them are a whole bunch of bees with their heads in the cells, okay? So they starved there. But if you just look an inch or two around that, there's honey, new pollen, and maybe even a whole box of honey, you know, that's up above, a lot of that, which is, we saw a great deal of that last year too. And that has to do with how many winter bees the cluster had, okay? Or it has to do with the viruses that the bees went into the winter with, and all the viruses shortened their lives. So that as the winter went on, the bees that were supposed to last till now, okay, only lasted till about mid-January, the first week in February, okay, which is when we saw most of those gone. So you say, what's the solution to that? And again, we used to talk about, it's just a matter of making sure that the bees had plenty of time to raise a large cluster of winter bees. It's turned out it takes more than that. If you look at that, the winter bees that are being raised, okay, and you look at who's raising the winter bees, of course it's nurse bees, right? So there's nurse bees that are steady feeding those larvae that are going to be winter bees. If they have viruses, they pass viruses to the larvae that they're raising, the bees they're raising. So it becomes important that the nurse bees that are going to be raising winter bees need to be healthy. They need to be disease-free. So that means backing up your mite treatment all the way to like the second the third or last week in July. That then gives the bees, you knock all the mites down, who are the main vector of all the viruses, that gives the bees an opportunity to clear their own bodies of these viruses that they have. I used to say develop antibodies, but I learned recently bees don't have antibodies. So they have other ways of clearing the viruses, you know, from them. They need to have time to clear the viruses out so that the nurse bees then are virus-free when they start raising winter bees. That makes sense? So much earlier, treating for mites much earlier than we thought. Than we thought we should. So we're talking, as soon as you take honey off, if you take your honey off in July, which you know, which I do, then you should be ready to do something about your mite numbers right away. I am an organic gardener from way back then. I believe in using organics whenever you can in your hive. However, I think you're also responsible for all those little sparks of life, those tens of thousands of little sparks of life, you know, bees that you have in there, that you're responsible as a beekeeper to do everything that you can to keep them alive and going. Okay? So if your attitude is, I'm not gonna do anything with these bees, I'm not gonna touch them. They either live or they die. I can tell you they're gonna die. Okay? They either live or they die, and if they just happen to have the genetics, they would help them live, well, great. And if they don't, well, too bad. If that's the kind of beekeeper that you are, you're really a bee haver, because you're really not doing any bee management, right? Stop keeping bees. Is that shocking you not? That's, you know, I firmly believe that you have a responsibility to do all you can to keep your bees alive. I have 7 colonies, that's all I have. I'm not allowed to compete with y'all. We used to have between 40 and 50. Years back, but I can't sell honey, I can't sell bees, I can't do, you know, anything that would take away from what you all could possibly do. Those 7 colonies that I had last year, as we came through the summer, I want to expand, I want to double that number, and the following year double it again, blah blah blah, try and get back up to where we were before, so that when I retire, which is a few years off, we'll have the kind of hives that we have. I treated my bees with Apivar this year. And that is not an organic. It's a synthetic. But it is super effective. It's still really effective. And I treated my bees with Fumagilla for Nocema this year too, both in the fall and in the late winter, both of those. All seven colonies of mine have come through. And they're all looking strong, looking good. So I feel good about that. I don't feel good about the methods that I use to get them there. Yeah. I think that as a beekeeper, you're responsible to do whatever it is that it takes to keep your bees alive. And if that means that sometimes you have to compromise, you know, on your feelings about organic versus not organic or that kind of thing, well then so be it. Okay. Same, you know, if your dog got sick, I mean, you wouldn't just hang in and see what happens and see if it lives or not. No, you would take it to the vet, and if the vet says give it this medication or that medication, then you would do that. Same if you had cattle, you know what I mean? Any other livestock. You have to look at the little individual lives of all those bees. Or if you want to think of it as a superorganism altogether, the colony being an organism, it's your responsibility to do all you can to keep them going. And if you don't want to take on that responsibility, then support beekeeping some other way, other than killing one colony after another, after another, after another. Okay? Now the bee breeders, if they're in here, would probably be smacking me in the back of the head. What are you saying to them? Let them kill bees, because they like that just fine. Keeps them in business. Okay, so don't rely on bee source experts. Instead, go after reputable sources. I'll tell you what I did when I first started beekeeping back in the early 80s, I guess it was I hooked on to two books that were written by the same author. Okay, I didn't know anything about who were good beekeepers and who weren't in terms of books and that kind of stuff. I just hooked on to two, and I just followed the systems that this person had done. They actually came from a family in California that had record-breaking honey production from individual hives. Okay, so they had this way of producing all kinds of honey. So I just followed what they did. I stuck to their system. Good or bad, right or wrong, you know, that got me through learning about beekeeping. I suggest that you do the same. Pick a source. It might be a book that you have, like for instance, I like the Beekeeper's Handbook, which is Diane Santero. I think that's a especially good one for new beekeepers and for intermediate beekeepers. And just follow how it is that person does it. It's the jumping around. Well, listen, this person on Bee Source, and then this other person in my meeting, I asked a question and got 25 different answers, you know, on that question. Trying to sort out a whole bunch of different people's opinions can get difficult. I don't know, you people have been keeping bees for a long time. Would you agree with that? A lot of people who I've been keeping bees for some time learned it from a parent or a grandparent, that way, from a relative. So, reputable sources and adopt what they have in common over time. And I'll wake you up for a couple. If you can't read this one says, "How have we made enough money now? I demand you take the rest of the week off. Let's have some beers." And down here is the first and last bee king. And then this one, of course, has honeybees die after they sting you. He says, "Oh, I got a wing cramp." And I was going ahead. Does anybody have any questions or thoughts from this?
Is there ever a time where you allow the bees to swarm on their own, or in reason?
Can anybody think of a reason why it would be good for your bees to swarm? Unless you have the idea, well, I'm going to try and populate the woods with you know, colonies of bees.
I don't know, if you weren't for honey production, or you know, if that wasn't what you're doing.
It would definitely, allowing your colonies to swarm will definitely cut into your honey production in a big way.
Right.
So,
I got an answer for that. A couple years ago, Dr. Stan Snyder at UNC, he let colonies swarm, but again, you got to think they were observation colonies that he run experiments on. So his study was actually swarming tendencies, and again, those bugs were under before the swarming, and so they actually had observation colonies they on purpose let swarm. But again, I know some guys that caught some of those swarms, because of course they went out into the landscape and a couple of the boys doing maintenance around there said, oh boy, somebody caught the swarm bees over there, but they looked like baseballs. There's a lot of baseball, they baseball like swarms. But again, on purpose, even one of them swarmed, yes.
That's part of the research.
Yes.
Yes.
Would you mind just elaborating a little bit more on queen substance? And what it is and how it affects swarms? A little more.
Sure, if you like. I'm not gonna try and produce from memory the name of the compound. Though after the meeting, I can certainly give it. It is a compound that is made by the queen's body, okay, and identifies her. Okay, there's no one else whose bodies make that. And it is distributed by contact. You have to through the workers throughout the whole hive. And the message to all the bees with the queen substance is that we have a functioning laying queen, okay, alive, healthy, et cetera, and it serves to keep the colony together.
Is that equivalent to a pheromone?
Yes, it's, okay. It's certainly a pheromone. Mm-hmm. Yes,
sir. When you said that separates the queen from the colony,
mm-hmm.
Putting her in a cage and leaving her in the hive won't keep her from swarming, right?
Not necessarily, no. But you do, and if you think of the Del Rey method, the queen's still there. Mm-hmm. She's just separated in space from the rest of the colony, and that makes it so that the queen substance that is in.
But you don't have extra equipment to stack on there with that. Just catch her.
You can try that, and then go through and destroy every single queen cell. As long as the little cage is there, they can feed her and take care of her, you know, through that.
But they still won't. They might still think she's there, and then she'll go with them.
Possibly, which would mean the workers would leave, and then they would discover they don't have their queen, and they would come back again. So they might try that over. Yes. Yes.
When you put the virulent swarm control like that, you put the queen down below. Mm-hmm. Does that not limit how many eggs she lays?
Yes, it does.
So in essence, you're cutting down on the amount of bees you have to collect next to.
Right. That's right. Well, you're cutting down the potential. In other words, if she could lay, you know, freely down there, then that would be that big an increase in bees. But remember that part of the problem that brought you to the swarm situation is overcrowding. So you already have a lot of bees, assuming that you have regular Langstroth size equipment. So yeah, I mean, you could think of, well, yeah, that does limit, since she's only on two frames, you know, essentially that she could possibly lay in. She doesn't have the room for 1,000 a day, you know, kind of. But that, I guess you could say that that's a part of the price that you pay in order to keep the whole colony together, to keep all those foragers together. I have to go. I'm trying to hear you. Yes, ma'am.
Now, you said that the two frames with the queen on the bottom, but the rest of the frames, are they supposed to be empty frames with just the wax? Or?
She's asking if the on the bottom of the Demarain method, we have the two frames that have a queen on it, the rest of the frames that are in there, they should be empty comb or foundation, either one.
That's why I need the foundation.
Yes.
But no other bees.
I mean, no, and you can freely go up and down. So the ones that are on top, you know, will come down. Yeah. The Demarain method, Google it and listen to other people's explanations on how you do the Demarain method. Sometimes you read them and go, what? But mine was crystal clear. It's taking the principle of separating the queen from the rest of the bees so that they think they don't have a queen. In other words, you've created a swarm kind of condition. Queen's down here, yes, but all these bees up on top, they now don't have a queen, which is how it would be when the queen mother first leaves with half the workers, right? So you're kind of creating what it's like after the swarm for the rest of the bee population, other than the queen. It's reasons.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
But adding a super on top, would that slow them down or that?
Giving them more room to process nectar, et cetera, that may help, you know, early on, just to expand things so that they're not trying to find places down in the brood boxes for
the processing. Main swarm cells, they're going.
Yes, if you see swarm cells, you know that it's underway, the swarm, and that it's a challenge for you to try and keep that colony together, try and keep them from half the workers. Yes, sir.
What are your thoughts on separating a possible potential swarm with two queen excluders?
In other words, a double screen kind of thing, much like that. So if you would have one swarm on the bottom, another on top above that, each have their own entrance in and out. The one on the bottom helps keep the other one warm, I suppose, if that matters to you.
Is there any data on whether the mother queen or queen mother is the more likely one that will swarm as opposed to one of the new emerged queens?
Yep. Yeah, and one thing that Dr. Karen means by first-year queens are the most productive and the least likely to swarm. So each progressive year after, in terms of age of queen, more and more likely to cast swarms. Yes, sir.
What is when they swarm, you catch the swarm, put a queen excluder on the other where they came out of and put them on top of it, and so they're still working right through the same line.
Mm-hmm. And that's fine as long as you make sure that there are no other queen cells anywhere in the rest of the hive. If you don't, then as soon as one of those queens emerges, she very well may leave with that.
So you catch that one, put those two together.
You can do that. It means keeps, as long as you have enough queen excluders.
And then at the end of the year, you can either take it out. Right. I have two hives.
Yep. Yeah, once the main flow is over with most all of these, you can combine them back together again if you choose. Okay. Yes.
Will a virgin hatch in that situation get through a queen excluder and try to kill the queen mother?
Well, most of the virgin queens that I've seen would have no trouble getting through an excluder.
But they'll go after the queen mother if she's still there?
Not necessarily. Now remember, in the swarming season, you can have the queen mother in the hive and various of those virgin queens emerge and they all coexist. On the other hand, if you were to look at, say, in mid-July, you know what I mean, in June, for instance, when the bees have decided that the queen is not producing how it is that they think she should, either egg laying or pheromone production, either one of those, and they decide to replace her. So then they're doing supersedure. That's where they build the cells up on the sides of the frame rather than on the lower margin. Those bees, as they emerge, will fight with each other. Whereas during the swarm season, the ones that are down on the bottom, as they emerge, they tolerate each other. In fact, sometimes after it's spring swarm season, you'll end up with a queen mother and one of the daughters too, both in the same hive. Typically what happens is the queen mother doesn't survive all that long. The workers dispatch her and go with the younger queen, often happen. Not always, but it's hard to tell which one's going to come out for sure. I would say that it's more likely that the younger one is the one that they'd rather have. It's a fair amount of production. It's usually stronger with younger queens than it is with older ones. Any other questions?
How long would you leave it like that?
The demerara method?
Yeah.
I would leave that way until the main nectar flow is over, which for me is like first week of June. But same here too. I live an hour away. It's an hour to your west, northwest.
Have you ever been to Spokane Bee Farm in Florida, Virginia?
I have not. I have heard of it, but I have never been there.
Any more questions? We can make up some more answers. Thanks a lot.